So I would remind you what was our theme. So our theme was about application of print and packaging technologies. Okay. So I would like to call upon our EFI sponsors onto the stage to be the part of the panel. And our sponsors are Toby, Steve, and Sam. May I request you to please come on the stage, please? So we would like you to take the left side of all the three seats. And I would also like to call upon our advisors to please come up on the stage. So Asha, DJ, Mr. Jagdish, Gautam, Mr. Sachindra, Himanshu, please do come up, and Mr. Prasad. Okay, so now that we have set the context from the morning, as in what the theme is all about, and we have seen our esteemed advisors presenting about different technologies, so I would like to ask Ramu to just give a brief context, and we would ask our sponsors to start with the question. Okay. So,
Okay.
So the context is actually the, you know, I mean, a lot of print, we talk about the technologies, we talk about the markets, we talk about future projections. So the whole idea behind this particular panel discussion is to look at some of the work, A, that has happened, and also the kind of tweaks that they have probably done on their respective shop floors, in terms of some kind of relearnings or learnings that they've had inside their own organization, or a print buyer that has come up with an, you know, unusual request and they've had to sort of create something for that. So that's broadly the thing. Since we are a bit short on time, I'll cut down on this and I'll just hand it over to Sam and Steve so that they can take the discussion forward. Steve, if we can, I can request you to, you know, you've got a sort of sense of what has been going on since morning. Some of them have done a bit of sharing in terms of the work that they've done, whether it's in textiles, whether in POD, whether in ceramics, or the kind of work Gautam's been doing with, you know, smart cards and so on. If you can give us just a sense of what's happening in the West, one or two interesting things that transpired with a couple of your clients, a couple of case studies, so that we also get a sense of what's happening, you know, worldwide. So if you could probably do that. Yeah, sorry.
Sorry, you're asking us?
Okay. No, so I wasn't there for the EFI Connect, but I know that there was a lot of things that were shared, and you know, so some interesting things that emerged so that we could get a sense of that. Yeah.
So nobody wants to bell the cat first, so I'm going to do it. You know, couple of key observations. You know, one observation from Connect was clearly, you know, the industry is extremely vibrant globally. You know, there was a lot of energy. You could see the numbers had swelled significantly. There was a lot of optimism in, you know, all the business heads who showed up there. There's a lot of optimism about the business. Good news. So the macroeconomic conditions for our industry looked very vibrant, and that's a good news. And usually, you know, U.S. the bellwether, and then, you know, rest of the world follows. And there was clearly a lot of energy there. The second observation that I can say I had was, you know, we used to have customers that were non-intersecting. We used to have the fiery customer, which was independent. We used to have MIS customers, which were mostly, you know, offset or commercial, and we used to have inkjet customers. That was a different segment, and it was very clear that they have started overlapping, which means, you know, It's no longer, you know, I'm a digital printer, or I'm an offset printer, or I'm this or I'm that. It's kind of like what you said, you know, Repro can print one book at a time or 10 million books at a time, and they just use the appropriate technology to do that depending upon what the need is. And so it's no longer, you know, it's no longer sort of religious about the technology. It's more about, you know, I'm in a particular business, and that business, whatever it requires me to do, you know. So that was clear. And that's great, because our story has been about bringing all these pieces together and integrating. Toby, you want to add some?
Sure. It was a great conference, to be honest. With Sam said, it's hard to explain the energy. You almost have to feel it. There was 1,500 people in attendance, which makes it a pretty big conference. And in addition to the comments Sam made, I think we're starting to see it become more international. Whereas it was originally a U.S.-focused conference, we had participation from 25 different countries this time. And I think the thing that makes it a success is the amount of education. You know, of course, we have some fantastic keynotes. We had the largest printer in the U.S., R.R. Donnelly, and also 3D Systems, the largest 3D printing. And so we had the 2D and the 3D contrast. But, the customers I spoke to, I think when they get the most value out of it is just all the education that's offered there. They told me they were pressed for time, that they were really having to make choices. Do I attend the session on how to implement a management information system, or do I attend this other session on color management and or best practices or how to grow your revenues? And that's good because you know, that implies there's many opportunities. Opportunities for them to save money, opportunities for them to grow their business, opportunities for them to get into color management. And I think a lot of that is because of what Sam said. They're no longer just, oh, I'm an offset printer with one facility and, you know, one or two customers, or I'm a quick printer, I'm a this. Actually, they're able to offer a whole bunch of services to their customers across the country and across the world. And that means that, you know, they really have a lot of learning to do on the technology side, how to make it all work together. One thing in common, though, that I did hear this morning as well is the education piece is a big deal. They're all struggling as businesses with how to bring in new people. Where can they get them from? How do they attract them into the industry? You know, how do they keep them in the industry? How do they train them? This is, I think, a common theme across you know, all the customers that I spoke to. And so we'll all just have to continue to work better to figure out you know, how to do that. That came up as a challenge I heard throughout this morning's presentations. So Connect was really great. I don't know if there's anything you wanted to add, Stephen?
Thanks, Toby. Toby's correct. We had a really good turnout from Asia this year in Connect. It's a long way for people to go, but this year was probably record turnout for Asian customers. I know all the EFI folks, the developers and the product managers got a lot out of talking to customers about what they need, because they're by far the best people to give us that feedback. You know, you're the folks that use the technology every single day. You mentioned trends, Ramu. If I look across Asia at the moment, you know, Toby's right. The days of just being a traditional offset printer are kind of long gone. You know, the trends left the station. A lot of printers these days are becoming very diversified. They have a blend of digital and offset. We're seeing more and more interest in sort of wide format as a new evolution, which is very interesting for us because that's a big part of our business in the inkjet side. It gives diversification to a traditional printer. And we're seeing a huge amount of interest in automation. You know, the cost of people everywhere, I guess, in the world, particularly in Asia, is becoming more expensive. So the days of being able to efficiently track jobs, track costing, make sure the logistics are all working efficiently. The room in Connect in Vegas was just full of solutions with our productivity suite software and web to print solutions. And I know the customers really got a lot out of that. And a lot of that product is developed by all these extremely talented people here. So So that for us is growing rapidly in Asia. You know, we're high double-digit growth for a productivity software. High double-digit growth for our wide format business, particularly LED, which is, without exaggerating, transforming the market in terms of high quality, which is all driven by brands. So these luxury goods brands demand a lot in terms of color integrity in their products. And so LED resonates with them. So I will say that I've, over the years, I've visited India a lot. And I will say that right now, I think this is probably the most, if I look at sentiment, it's the highest I've ever seen it, business sentiment in India, which is great. So I hope everybody capitalizes on that, because it's not going to be there forever. And whatever assistance you need from Sam and the EFI team in India, we're here for you. So, and I've really enjoyed today, so thanks very much, sir.
Hello. Sorry. DJ, this question's for you. I mean, I think the first time or the second time when I'd come over to your unit and, you were doing all this really extraordinary work and creating, fabrication and all sorts of design patterns. And I asked you, what's the sort of secret to your success? And you said something interesting. I don't know if you remember now. This was ages ago. You said that we spend 10% of the time we spend 10% of our time on what we do well and 90% of our time on what we could keep doing better. So if you can just dwell for us, in the context of what we discussed the last time when we were on the stage, what is that 90% that you're spending your time on these days?
Yeah, good evening, everybody. Yeah, Ramu, you're right. It's a fact that, a lot of the time we spend trying to dwell on what we do, but we miss out on all the stuff that we haven't been doing well or what we need to do. So just by nature, right from the beginning, probably because I started off 30 years ago when we didn't have technology, we didn't have the means, we didn't have knowledge, we didn't have what we have today. So a lot of it we had to pioneer, we had to figure out on our own. So there were a lot of things that went going right which needed fixing. So the moment my job was more to fix what was not right, I had a good team of people who could carry on doing the job of doing what was okay. So I was blessed to have had an excellent team of people. I just had to give them something which was done, they would do. But I always said that if there was a problem, then that was my problem. So that was stuff that I needed to fix. Now, for example, we're talking about applications here. One of the most challenging applications that I ever had to do was when we got this customer of ours who came and said, I have a cargo plane and I want a wrap. Now, we have done fleet graphics for cars and vans and buses, but an aircraft? I said, aircraft, no, we don't, that's not something, that's a very special. Says, no, this is, I'm starting this company, and I'm starting this company next month, and I need to have this, and I need, so I've taken an Air India plane on lease, and I want, right now it's got Air India markings, and I want Ace Cargo markings on it. Ace Cargo with his blue, orange, and white stripe. So I told him, I said, we are not FAA and your director, DGCA approved. He said, I'll get all that done. But can you do it? I said, well, theoretically, we can do it. So when I checked with the team, everybody said no. And anyway, to cut a long story short, this guy said, listen, I want you to do it. It doesn't matter if the plane doesn't take off. If I don't get the permissions, it's my problem. I want you to do it. So now the first thing he did is, okay, so give us have you got the artworks? He said, I've got my logo, and I've got a PDF of an Airbus A310 aircraft. That's it. So So I had to, so typically that's what I do. I said the shortcut was to send, I had a team of people, I could have said, go to Bombay Airport and check it out. Too critical to do it. I said, when you're doing something like this, you need to own that risk, you need to own that responsibility. So I went, you know, old as I am. This was 5 years ago, so it's just 5 years younger. So I went up there, I said, I need to see the aircraft. It was there in the hangar. I got myself into one of those fire engine buckets, got it pushed up, went up, checked the aircraft to see the body. And I said, I think it's doable, but the permission is yours. So anyway, we did it with just one PDF of the aircraft as dimensional drawing. But I just validated it by taking a quick measurement of the tail from top to bottom. And I didn't realize that a tail of an A310 is 27 feet, you know, just the top portion. But I needed to do it just to validate the PDF. We said it's fine. We printed it, we tiled it, we applied it. The plane, he actually got permission, it actually flew, and it's still there in Bombay Airport at the moment. So, coming back to what you do, you've got to, if you own your business, you've got to take responsibility, you've got to do the hard part of it, and you've got to be able to build a team who will take up after you. I'm not going to do the next one, but the first one I will do. That's sure. Right.
Jagdish, the next question is for you. I mean, there are two things. You should know that I sort of spend a lot of time with your brother. So that's one. The second thing is that, you know, I stay, when I come to Bangalore, I normally stay with family. And there's a young niece, and, you know, she keeps asking me, where do you go? So the last time when I was there, I think I told her I'd gone to Rajhans. She had not heard the name. Then I said I went to Manjushri. She had not heard the name. And then I took the name of your organization, and she said, yes, I know. And she rattled off all these sort of outlets which you have. I think she mentioned four. You have five or six right now, right, in Bangalore.
Yeah.
So two questions, really. What, obviously, it's a retail model that you've worked out. And it's not the traditional, what the other players have been doing in terms of a hub and a spoke, but it's been sort of standalone units that you have in each suburb of Bangalore. How difficult was it to set all this up? Because Bangalore is not a very transportable city like, say, Mumbai is. How difficult was it to set up? And B, what has been the sort of, footfalls that you're seeing at each of these outlets so that we get a sense of what's happening in Bangalore on the ground?
Yeah, we are two of us, my brother and me. So we got into this business, and our main focus is we do any printing. It can be one or two or any quantity. And the focus is quality is important. Color is very important. If the customer is not satisfied, please rectify the file or suggest to the customer that this is probably the reason what we best understand it to be. And I think the thing is that when digital was launched, we were the first early adopters of the technology itself. So right in the starting, we were probably the first people in India to have the digital printing machines. So that gave us a little lead. And we are not the normally CEOs sitting in a cabin or something.
Correct.
You'll probably find us on the shop floor itself. So that's our job. We work during the day and deliver whatever best we can. And what I've learned is that we try our best to understand where the customer is coming from. So I feel that has been the key to our loyalty of our customers, because when they speak to us, they are sure ki they know I am where they are coming from. And we try our best to deliver. Timelines have become very tight now. People want everything very quick.
Yep.
So we just keep focusing on this.
But most of your customers are walk-ins, right? Almost 90% would be walk-ins?
No, it's not like that. We have a mix of customers. They're all walk-ins and corporates. If I may be right, also it could be a little wrong. We have printed for every corporate who has stepped into India.
Okay.
So it's any name you take, has definitely been our customer. We may not have scaled up to his level of different things, but we have done small works for them. And whatever we have done for them, I think they are happy, so they keep coming to us.
Sure. And would you be the largest sort of HP Indigo customer base in Karnataka today in terms of the number of machines that you own?
I really don't know, but I think we got 4 machines. But there are other people also who have put a lot of machines. So
sure.
I really don't know that,
sure,
whether we are largest or not. But I hear from them that we are doing decently well.
Okay. Understated as usual. Ashaji, I wanted to ask this for a long time, but you know, I've been to Morbi twice, and my memory of Morbi is, of course, the Doodh Pak, because I think it's sort of, so Doodh Pak is something like your kheer, and if you ever go to Morbi to, you know, pick up ceramic tiles, do have Doodh Pak there, it's absolutely, but what is it really, you know, what made Morbi tick? So we used to ask this question to a lot of people there, ki Shivakasi, there are some historical reasons, Ludhiana, there are some reasons, but Morbi just seems to have sort of unexpectedly, you know, so if for our sake to understand that how this town, which is whatever 200 kilometers north of Ahmedabad, how exactly did it become a hub in such a big way? Is it something to do with a community? Is it something to do with sourcing of ceramics? What happened in Morbi?
I think it's a combination of both the factors that you mentioned. One is the proximity to the raw materials, close to Rajasthan, and probably Morbi was one of those regions that had natural gas at a very early stage in their industrialization. And obviously, Gujarat has always been given a big thrust to industry. And the family culture has helped them to succeed very well. They're very committed to business. They don't have a Sunday. So as a customer for a Morbi, as a supplier to a Morbi customer, you cannot say on a Sunday morning that, sorry, it's a Sunday, I'll get back to you on Monday. You have to address their concerns, even if a call comes to you on Saturday night at 10 o'clock or Sunday morning 6 o'clock. So that's the spirit with which they work. And probably that's what made them or brought them to where they are today.
Sure. And right now, what is happening? I mean, has there been greater organization? You mentioned that there is a shift in the units.
Yep.
But I haven't been to Morbi, I must say, for the last 6 years or so. But has there been some change in the township itself? Because the condition of the town was not, I mean, infrastructurally, there was still a lot of work that needed to be done.
There's not been significant change in the township, but there has been a lot of expansion.
Okay.
A lot of new units come up almost every year.
Okay.
Sometimes it results in a problem of overcapacity. But the good thing about Morbi is the cluster advantages that it offers. Technology is shared, ideas are shared,
yeah,
and one industry's problem is the problem of the entire industry. If one person has a coal gas factory that's being shut down, the entire industry is ready to support them to fight for that.
Sure.
So that way, I think they have a very positive spirit that makes them expand very fast.
Right. Okay, Himanshu, the questions for you, 2 questions. You're obviously second generation at Avantika, and you know, I know your father, he's a mathematician and he's a scholar, but he's also an extremely difficult person to work with. So, how difficult is it for you to sort of convince him about many things? That's question number 1. And question number 2, I don't know if you've got that sample, the book that was presented to the president of the US, if you have a sample of that, or if you don't, then you can just share with us what was the unique thing that Avantika did with that, because I think that was also quite a special job.
First thing, the difficult question. Dad, actually, I have to come up with various new ideas to get back to him to convince him on one point, again and again. Sometimes, maybe he convinces in a day or 2, or sometimes it takes even 1 month for me to convince him. Like, I want to shift into a new plant because the US
space,
a place of space constraint. He's not ready to move out, but in the recent days past, I have convinced him to move out of that place to go to a bigger place so that our workflow seems quite faster. Second, Gandhi book. we got it as a referral to do in a print on demand book. They had at least around 15 books to be given to Prime Minister Modi so that he can take all those books along with him in the US trip. And apart from gifting it to Mr. Obama, he also gifted to several other dignitaries, and we published it on our OSEC 6160. Wow. And fabricated it in-house by gold leafing and other parts.
Sure. And that was the other thing. A lot of the work that you do, I mean, of course, you print digitally and so on. But, I mean, one is your strong sort of understanding of screen printing. I think almost 30 to 25% of embellishments that you'll do is with screen printing.
Yes.
So if you can just share, you know, what is it about screen printing that you find so advantageous? Is it the sort of special texturing, the layering? What is the kind of work that you'll do? Because that seems to be what makes you, sets you apart from other digital players.
Okay. What I have seen screen printing when I joined my business is a rectification tool, whatever mistakes we have done. I got my hands-on experience on that as that tool. But in the event we exponentially grow, then we thought of screen printing as an additional tool. We can do something which we cannot replicate on our digital presses, like gold color printing or any fluorescent color printing. We were not able to achieve it on a digital press. So we make a combination of those things in that fashion. First we print digitally, then move forward for our screen printing unit, get it all done, and then deliver it to client.
Sure. Mr. Urappa, the questions to you, it's sort of natural flow from a different kind of screen printing. I know that you're adding one more very high-end, you know, Sakurai at your Bangalore unit. So your presentation was a sort of eye-opener for a lot of us. But if you can also share with us what is actually happening in two spaces. One is sportswear and the other is children's wear. And what is it that, what is India's role going to be, you know, if we want to be destinations for these two, you know, verticals, sportswear and children's wear? I know you're doing a lot of work in that space. Yeah.
Yeah, market, if you look at Indian market for the sportswear and children wear, it is not a great deal, because we supply our sportswear product for Nike, Indian cricket, IPL and all. But you look at the volume, what they're using in the football match, European league. One league, if you take it, it's million piece print. One league. It's huge.
Yeah.
Unbelievable volume. All these prints are coming from Taiwan at the moment. Taiwan didn't have that capacity to handle everything. The businesses started moving to Sri Lanka, actually. Sri Lanka is far. There is getting irritated to us. So market for Indian market is not there. If you look at the export market, particularly sportswear is the big market, more than children wear. In the children wear garment, printing normal, some of the stores like H&M, Marks & Spencer, they are planning to open up the stores. But we already have a bigger volume for those kind of Marks & Spencer or H&M for the European market. So what they're opening in India is not an additional for us. It may be a small addition compared to what we are doing already.
Sure. And if you can again just share, because I know you have a lot of working relationship with the players in Tirupur. So what exactly is, you know, the nature of the relationship and how does the partnership work? So in terms of supply chain and so on.
Yeah. We had a tough time when we started Tirupur, very honest. My MD, Mr. David Hunt, he used to go to Tirupur, and myself, we traveled. The attitude of the Tirupur manufacturer, cheap.
Correct.
Whatever they get, you know, like if they're having, if want, they can make it 70% profit, and they don't want to pay for the fabric, they don't want to pay for the print, they won't want to pay for the accessories, good time. So constantly, they don't mind even their garments to come back, because some of the print, what they're using, when it goes to US market or any European market, they said, oh, print is peel out, one wash. I'm returning all your concern, but those kinds of things, it took us actually 3 to 4 years to develop the Tirupur market. We developed the Sri Lankan market faster than the Tirupur. But after going and constantly they're seeing our product, educating them, look, print is very minimum, less than 5% of their value, but something goes wrong, it will close your business, you know. That way we have, now we are dealing with very reputed in Tirupur, at least 12-15. Don't go to small supplier in Tirupur. Their mentality is slave. I always explain when I go, you get meal in roadside Darshini, you get meal in 5-star. Why the price difference? Because of the quality. If you want quality, come to us. Otherwise, we are not there.
Sure. Mr. Prasad, is this a model that can be followed in the wide format OOH space? Something similar to what Mr. Udappa mentioned. I know you've been eloquently arguing about this for a very, very long time, that India is the only country where I think we follow Newton's law of gravity very seriously, that the price keeps falling and keeps falling.
Normally, we are dealing with Ethiopia, Indonesia, Sri Lanka and all. Supply customer in the garment industry particularly, treating the supplier as like, I'm doing a favor. I given you order, you're doing a favor. Even it is 5,000 rupees value, take this order I've given. But it is not the case. In the countries, upcoming countries like Sri Lanka and all, they treat, can you spare us your capacity for this much order? That is the language they use.
Sure.
Big, huge difference.
Sure.
Well, hello. Can you hear me? No? Yeah, well, it is, you know, our white format industry, printing industry is, in general, is the most unorganized. Thereby, this is where the business for you all guys did. Anything unorganized, you can organize something here, with your softwares or with your hardwares. So that's the best business to be in today. The last 15 years, this business has been unorganized and has not been organized as yet. Well, the question that what Ramu asked me is the same that pressure on the price. 15 years back, and DJ knows very well, he was doing this much volumes and then the profits are high here. Okay. The volumes are here, the profits are here. The work has increased, but the organizational method that's supposed to go into the system, it has not gone as it. So everyone in this industry is pretty busy from morning to evening. I was a little surprised when madam told me that, you know, the guy in Murgi, he can't say no even he calls up in the midnight or in the Sunday or Saturday evening. I'm a little happy that there's another industry which is also the same as ours. I think there is a lot of gap. I still, you know, I want to tell you guys, there's a lot of gap still lying in our industry. Something the software can do for this, which a lot of people not able to notice that, or maybe that the industry leaders are not able to explain that well, or they find this is not profitable enough to get into this kind of a line, so that is why it is. But I think the end user, you know, the most organized client, let's say Shell, is a very big company. But when you need a requirement of this particular industry's print, it gets disorganized completely. I think I think you must have got a point. What I'm saying that, you know, you can get in here, you have something lot more to do here. But the one which is organized, I think offset line is more or less is very organized today. You don't have to have, of course, the short runs is going to be a little difficult, tough time for them. They're also finding it very tough to deliver it. It's like, you know, the print newspaper has to get into the smartphone, the same news tomorrow. That industry is getting disorganized completely. So there is a lot of chaos there. But here, what going to come in the newspaper has to be up on the hoarding. It has to be up on the shop. The time given for this and for that is almost same. So I think you have a lot of opportunities in this line.
Yeah. Right. And what happens to, you know, a space which you're comfortable with, which is airports? Yeah. Airports. So, for example, there's, you know, some statistics about 17 international airports coming in, 30 odd new ones coming in. Is this sort of a space which we as an industry should be looking at working together collectively instead of individual organizations, so that, you know, these 50 or 60 new airport projects that are going to come in, you have print as a sort of key component with it, and, you know, you're partnering with the Lakshas or the JC Ducos and, you know, making sure that these projects are A, viable, profitable, and also, of course, well executed. Is that something that can be thought out right now?
Well, it's a brilliant opportunity that Our airports are getting international. We already have about 8 of them, which is done well. Then we have another 45 of them are in the line. So this is a big opportunity. I remember one of my, I just recall that one of my meeting with the JCD chief here in India, a long back. I said from South Bangalore to go to the airport, it takes about 1.5 hour time. But when a print has to reach there and you mount it up, I have to print to the specifications that what the box that has got there, and then do the kind of arrangement what he requires and send it across there. The guy need to understand the kind of fabrication work he has done there earlier. The guy need to understand the print and also fabrication of that unit and then mount it up. I think it's going to be a lot of chaos, you know, there will be some mishaps. Why you have a contract with Bangalore Airport? Why don't you give me a place in airport itself so that I shift my printer there and put it up and then go and hang it up there?
That's a good idea.
I'll give you 10% less than what I'm charging you right now. It was, in fact, the same idea has been given to Hyderabad and OOH in Times OOH in Delhi. But you know, the cost of the place there is so exorbitant, it's 20 times more than your print cost.
True.
To stay there.
True. Yeah.
So better you deliver it late rather than, you know, getting there and paying the price they can finally get.
Sure. Yeah. So even the brands are not willing. I mean, they're looking at almost, 20 million, 30 million footfalls a day. So but they're not willing to sort of subsidize this?
Well, the cost of the real estate is pretty high over there to reach there.
Sure.
So this industry, I mean, the client is not willing to pay the kind of price that...
Sure.
Whereas people like DJ and me are willing to get in there, want to do that, give a quick service, world-class print. But the rest of the things doesn't allow us to do that.
Sure. Right.
Commercially, it doesn't... doesn't allow us, basically.
Correct. Yeah. Would any of the EFI team members want to sort of, since you've had a full round in a way? Yeah.
You know, I have a question for, I think anybody can answer. And it's not necessarily about printing per se, but it's about leadership, building business, etc. So a lot of you extremely passionate about your business. And like you said, DJ, you know, the first one you do it yourself. And then from the second one onwards, you know, you're hoping your team is going to do. How do you ensure that the same passion, same quality, same attention to detail, etc., persist? And, this is where I find a lot of times, you know, it's very hard for people to delegate. They kind of hold on too long and thus don't scale. On the other hand, Gautam said, it's very easy. He's got people. They just do it. So I don't know. Is there a formula you get there, or how are you guys doing it? Anybody, feel free.
We need a mic, I think.
Sam, I'll try and answer that. In my case, it's about, I try to say that I don't expect anybody to do anything that I can't do myself. So when I do it, it means you can do it, you know? And touch wood, my guys have looked up to me, and I always tell them that whatever you do, you got to remember that it reflects on the name of the company and it reflects on me. This, whatever we say, this is a personality-driven business. And I think Gautam talked about it in one of these things. When you're trying to, for example, if you're talking about consolidation, I think Gautam had a very valid point. He said, anybody can buy machines, anybody can buy the thing. You need to buy, if you're taking over a company, then you need to take over, who's the guy leading the company? And how will he fit in with you? Because he actually drives the business in the company. I once kind of shared with a senior mentor or friend of mine, and I told him, I've been able to delegate everything in my company from accounts from day one. I never really signed checks or do all that sort of stuff myself. I was able to do that, the operations, everything. I said the one thing that I find difficult is marketing. I said that my customers, my key customers, even though I have a team, will still call me. And you know what he told me? He said, why are you complaining? He says, that's the way it should be, because that's your hold. That's the most important thing. And you know, you need to build a second line, but remember that your business depends on those customers. So at an operational level, delegating, not a problem. Dealing with a customer, delegating it, I wouldn't do it lightly. I'd be very, I would do it very, very gradually and make sure that, you know, this person has to live up to my standards before I will let him front face my customer. That's it.
Gautam, was it always this easy as you make it to be, or did you have to actually do something to get there?
I think it was a step-by-step process, but if I try to simplify it, I would use the word ownership, right? We feel ownership, you know, when we start something, we own all of it, we are accountable, we are responsible. I think if you're able to bring the ownership in all the key people, we achieve the same amount of diligence, right? So I think that is what it's about. I would say two things. I think for me, we spend a lot of time in terms of when we take someone into the organization, when we have to take laterally, right, to make sure there's a very, very strong fit into the culture. And I think there's a very strong induction process. And initially, when we had professional leadership come in, I spent a lot of time with them. And the delegation has happened over a period of time, and then it flows down. So I think if that cultural fit is there, then you address all of it, because then they have the passion, they know exactly how to take decisions, they don't need to ask somebody. Like, to give you two examples, long back when Ramo was talking, early 2000s, when we didn't have a single focaler machine, there's an interesting story. I'm luckily a little calm by nature, I don't get worked up very easily. So I got a call maybe at 1 p.m. and not p.m., 1 a.m. in the morning. And one of the managers, Sudish, he was kind of crying on the phone. And I asked him, what happened? So he said the focaler machine, the first one which came in, fell down. The crane, they had lifted it up, moved it, and the workers working there, the contract workers, one of them was drunk or something, the chain broke and the whole machine fell down, right? And he was in a state of mind that he wanted to kind of kill himself. So that's the kind of passion he felt. So then my wife asked me what happened, you know. I said, the machine has fallen down. I told Sudish, go to sleep, just check if it's injured in the morning, right? Because you can't change anything, right? If it's fallen down, you have to just check how badly it's damaged, right? But that's the kind of passion or ownership they felt. Recently, we had a project where we did a very large examination, where about 2.5 million people took a test on the same day for 50,000 jobs. It was a very important, you know, government jobs in the north. And it was a paper exam. So we did the whole end-to-end where we took in the admission money from the students, booked the data, issued them hall tickets. Then we had to get the question papers to 1,500 centers in North India, hold the exam, collect the papers back, check the papers and declare the results. So it was 24 trucks of question papers which had to be shipped out to North India. And the roads to Bangalore, the guards were so bad, few of the question papers fell out, three boxes in the night, and the truck behind saw the boxes are missing. Now when you're doing an exam, whether it's one paper or a million papers, it's the same, because the values in the content, right? So the person running the business, the P&L of the business, he didn't have to ask anybody. He just took a decision on the spot to reprint the entire thing. He went and told the government, this is what has happened. The exam cannot be held because we have not found those three boxes. We're not sure if it's leaked, but it's a potential risk, right? And it was probably he lost, maybe at least close to maybe $1 million by reprinting it. But that's a decision it took. It's driven by the values of the company. He knew the company will stand by him. That brings, I think, ownership and then drives results. And the government appreciated that and compensated us for at least half that amount. But long term, that is built. So I think if that ownership comes in people, then it becomes easy to scale, because then you know people are doing exactly what needs to be done.
Sure.
That's amazing stories. Thank you. I have a question, anyone on the panel, actually. This morning, during the presentations, the idea of being green or eco-friendly came up in several of the presentations. I'm wondering, how real is that? Are your customers asking you, to do more to better the environment? Are they asking you to change processes, or so far this is just lip service?
There's a mic here.
As far as printing on eco-friendly paper, if you mean, is that what you...
It could be reducing waste or better for the environment or eco-friendly paper, anything.
Yeah, I mean, as far as printing on eco-friendly paper is concerned, people are looking towards that. But then when the cost of the media is added, because the paper which is coming is priced quite highly compared to what you're getting locally over here, they split the quantity into some portion. So they take some portion as eco-friendly and some portion which they feel they can think. But the change is happening. Like now in Bangalore, BBMP has announced that no billboards will be put up within city limits. So all printing facilities which have these machines which are not eco-friendly will have to move out of town. So it is coming. Then the corporates also are asking, is your media eco-friendly or not eco-friendly? It's a process, but it's not going to happen. I don't see it happening in a day or two, but it will take its time.
From my experience, I found that these are driven by the government. It's driven by legislation. It'll happen, it'll really happen only when legislation is enacted and enforced. I mean, every company and corporate has got its own CSR programs. They would like to do it, they would like to have it there on their paperwork. But when they realize that it costs $1 more than what the other one, booms, nope. But they'll do it only when they're forced to. So if you ask me, are they walking the talk? No. They are not walking the talk, but and I think anywhere, this is really going to be the, like you said, if the government brings in a law, everybody will have to follow it sooner or later. They want to do it on their own, they'll be happy to do it as long as you don't charge them anything extra. They will not pay for it, to my mind.
Can I share my experience? Hello? I would like to share my experience on this point, which is very relevant to what you asked. Supposing we had a customer base of, let's say, 100 customers, there would be maybe 15 or 20 customers who would actually insist on following the environmental standards and regulations, and they would make sure that unless we followed all of those, we would not be included in their supplier list. But in most cases, I think the onus is on the supplier to use that as a branding strategy and convey to the customer that we are superior in terms of environmental compliances. And that's probably how we can drive the point over to the customers. So 80% of the customers, onus is on us. 20%, it comes from the supplier, customer end.
I think my guess, in my guess, you know, if you want me to be very frank enough, like what DJ said is correct. The legislation is very important. You have a no entry board. People would like to take a chance, go and hit the other end. Get the police, get caught, pay the fine. Otherwise, no, you reach home. So that's the mentality that all of us. Customers will never ask give me a green product. I want to, I'm very concerned about the environment. Not even 1% till today I come across asking for that particular thing. What he needs is, first is timely delivery, two is quality, third is the price. So these three are sort, the rest is, his is, you know, is the leisure time that he talks about it. So these three first has to be connected to him. So I think the technology producers has to go to the legislation point, tell them the advantages of this, and then try to change that. Then it, I think it can happen. The client will start asking, well, I need this, man. Otherwise, I'll get fined. I get a penalties coming in. I get notices. Then he will start coming. So you don't have to go to your customer directly with a converter. Then you can go to your legislator and say that, okay, pass this through, then your customer comes to you. It's very simple.
In our case, anyway, we are supplying to European and US retailer. We have to use our raw material which comply with all their requirement. We cannot use any nasty chemicals. So we test all our ink and paper that is called Okotex Class 1. It is a German institute. Even if you use 100 kg of ink in a year, that need to go and test in the beginning of that. That certificate is valid for 1 year. Anything fails for the Okotex Standard 1, we cannot use it. With regards to environment, we treat our water and we generate some surplus treated water that will be used. We have a backside garden. We put a lot of Mexican grass. It consumes more of water. So not wasting any surplus water.
Last Olympics was completely on a green media. Yep. Done by the, supplied by the MacTech, printed by ViewTech. Most of it. This is what I heard. And it was there, I think there was a point driven there, we need to use only the green products there. Same it can come in even the Commonwealth Games that they can drive this point there. Do not use any non-green products. So that, you know, the technology producers has to tell them that. That so-and-so is available.
So are there any questions from the answers, from the audience? Because we'll, yeah.
I have a question.
Uda?
I have a question for you, Rami.
Yeah, okay.
It's a good question. So in terms of the Indian printing industry in 2015, what do you think is the biggest driver, going to be the biggest driver of growth this year? Is it the government infrastructure projects? Is it literacy increasing? Is it digital to analog transformation? What do you think is going to drive printing industry this year?
So I think the less the government intervenes, the better it is for us. I think that's clearly proved. And the second thing is, I think there's a lot of entrepreneurial energy, as you can sense from the panel itself. I mean, we are seeing exponential growth in most of the organizations we talk to. When we do the Print Week India Awards, we have to audit balance sheets. And we are seeing that the ratio of growth is almost now, 100%, 120%. And year on year, we are seeing that sort of, big development in terms of adding a new facility, adding a new project. So primarily entrepreneurial energy, and there is a lot of cash in the market, which I think is finally coming back. Some of the numbers that we heard from PrintPak, Plast India, a lot of cash inflow that is coming back into the, it is sentiment, nothing else, but I think that's helped the industry. Questions from the, yes.
Yeah, so this question is open to all the guests. So we have seen these print facilities of, different sizes, even worth about 1,000 crores like Mr. Gautam. So my question is more on the strategy side, is about, we don't see much mergers or acquisitions happening in this print domain, for the better applications of, the network or user base or technologies. So can you explain what is the reason for it, or do you see any prospects, or do you see any chances of happening this in a few decades from now? Is my question clear or should I repeat?
Yes, it's clear. The question okay. is fairly clear.
Let me check if I got the question right. You're asking if M&A is very, why M&A is not that active in the print industry. Was that the question?
That's exactly my question.
My personal opinion is that one of the challenges, like I was mentioning earlier, is that in M&A, you need to really get either, either you're buying it for the infrastructure or you're buying it for the customers or a kind of a niche, a capability or technology which you, don't have. I think the print industry equipment really you can buy, whether it's, second-hand or new, it's pretty easy to get. As far as customers, most of the customers' relationship are with the person running the organization, the promoter, right? So it becomes very, very complicated to get into a relationship where the promoter continues in the organization when he doesn't own it. It's very difficult for a person to let go or understand his position has changed, because it's not only externally to the world, but even internally his position would have changed, which is very difficult to manage. So because of that, I think it's very hard to do M&A with companies which are completely promoter driven. When you have professional management, I think it becomes easy. That is one reason. Second, I think in India, the valuation expectations sometimes are very challenging, because a lot of the print companies have real estate and the promoters expect a real estate value for it, which makes it completely unviable. Unlike in most Western countries, you don't own real estate in business, you keep it separate. Even if you have real estate, you treat that as a real estate business and you don't try to keep the real estate in the operating companies. In India, most of the manufacturing and print companies have real estate in them. So you'd have a company in Delhi which is not doing well, which may be losing money, but it has a couple of acres of real estate, which makes it completely unviable. So that's another big challenge, I think, which is there in M&A. And also in India, financing for M&A is very difficult. You don't traditionally get, you're not able to raise money on balance sheets alone. It tends to be project finance. So if you have to buy a company, you are able to raise money for the assets of the company, but not really what you need to pay the promoter. There's the expectation of goodwill and other things. So there are many challenging things like that. But I think eventually consolidation is going to be important, and I think we'll see accelerator of consolidation. I think it's going to happen more and more. Does that answer your question?
Yes, very much. Thank you.
But there are some big moves that are happening. I think there's AP and International Paper, there's Technova, Agfa, Manugraph, DGM, there's Hotamaki, paper products. So I mean, even in Scanem, Interlibles, these are all like big M&As that have transpired in the last 14 to 18 months. And I think next 8 months in the packaging and flexible packaging, I think there are at least six that we know of that's definitely on the rollout phase. Again, big players who are coming in, both in the narrow web labels. So people of the size and scale of the Rinders of the world, and also in the positive packaging. I mean, in the flexible packaging space.
Ramu, curiously, you see multinationals coming and acquiring Indian companies, but amongst Indian companies is not a very common practice. So that's a very peculiar sort of observation. The mileage varies quite a bit between the two scenarios.
Yeah, because I think we are one big joint family. So, so like Bhargavs, Dhotes, these are huge families with entities and units in different parts of the country.
Yeah.
Any, hello, Anthony here. This question is to Mr. Toby. So we have 3D printing that is making up prototypes and models. Do you think there is a possibility to print 3D, that is to have robotics, sensors, and CAD and Affieri to drive to print it directly on a 3D? Do you think such a possibility is there in the near future? Maybe even directly on automobiles?
That's a great question. You're probably asking the wrong person. If I was an expert in 3D printing, it would be a different panel. There's a tremendous amount of excitement in printing 3D circuits. Printing circuits themselves, and that itself is, I think, a huge opportunity. It would imply that in the future, one would be able to print the circuits inside of the 3D printed materials as well. That would certainly be, my guess as to how it would happen. I think manufacturing is going to be completely transformed at some point by this process. So if you took all of them combined, the ability to print circuits, combine that with 3D printing, add in some color management, why not? Why couldn't you make a fully functional product at some point from that? So, Mr. Pai is an expert or knows more.
No, I'm not an expert, but I attended a program where I got some exposure to 3D printing recently, and I think some of the key takes were that, I think the measure of progress of 3D printing is how much portion of a 3D printer is printed by a 3D printer, right? So essentially when it's 100%, that means it can self-replicate, right? So I think one thing which has been noticed is the performance of a 3D printer has been doubling every year. That means in terms of cost, speed, and materials it can use. So I think the change is very exponential. It's changing very fast. But I think we are still very far away from a 3D printer being able to print a 3D printer. But there have been a lot of innovations, and I think the three main industries which will be disrupted from 3D printing is basically manufacturing, logistics, and construction. You can Google it. There's a company, I think, called Wilson in China, which has built a three-story apartment building using a 3D printer. They're built in 24 hours. It's like a crane which deposits material, completely built a three-story apartment building in 24 hours. So it's moving very fast, the technology. We in our lab, use 3D printers to make prototypes for, verification device, etc. And it was built by one of the students in MIT. I think we spent like 40,000 rupees on it. It was completely built there in the lab, the 3D printer. I think it's going to change very fast. But I think, personally, I believe the money will be made in terms of someone who controls the content, because you may have 3D printers and all that, but then there's no standard for the CAD designs. Right, if you're able to have some, I think that's where the money really will be captured.
Yeah. Any other questions, team? Okay, so we promised 1 hour of Q&A for all of you. So now that we don't have questions, so we'll go forward with the next step. So thanks a lot, Ramu.
Thank you.
For completely taking the lead on the panel discussion. And thanks a lot, all our esteemed guests, for coming here and discussing, and we really got a lot of insights right from leadership to 3D printing. So thanks a lot. So let's give a huge round of applause to all our panelists. So in the last two advisory councils, so we made it special for all the advisors by giving a gift which depicts the capability of EFI. So first time we gave a ceramic tile which had a customized print. Second time we showed the strength of our fiery by immediately printing the photographs and giving them a photo frame. So my question to the panelists as a moderator is, guess what would be the gift this time?
A 3D BMW?
Oh! Okay, that's aspirational. Any other guesses? Okay, Prasad?
He knows.
I know that because someone has asked me from EFI, so I shouldn't say this to you.
Okay, because he knows it, so we'll give it to him. So I would like to call upon Toby to please give the gifts to our advisors to talk about the gift. So this is a print that we rendered using EFI Fiery Pro server, and we printed on ViewTech GS3250LX Pro with Ultra Drop technology. So when you have it in your hands, you will have the feel. So may I call upon Toby, please? So our first gift to Ms. Asha Sampath. So the team will give the gift from there. Ms. Asha, please, for you. For Mr. DJ. for Mr. Gautam Pai. Guys, give a huge round of applause. For Mr. Himanshu Pandey. Mr. Jagdish Bajaj. Mr. Prasad Bhagwat. So Prasad, because you have guessed it, so would you want to talk about it?
Yeah, I think someone has asked the question about, Tony has asked something about a green print. Yeah, this is what is a green print is all about. Like, one is textile, second is UV print on that. Now, there's a job, somebody has to legislate this.
Thanks, Prasad. So it's printed on canvas. It's an oil painting for the reality. Then the next gift is for Mr. Ramu Ramanathan for being the hero of the second half. We would like to thank Sachindra for showing wonderful samples on the textiles. We would also like to thank Steve for being here and giving us the perspective from the APAC region. We'd also like to thank Sam because he is the brain behind this. And last but not the least, Sam, why don't you come up on the stage? We have a special one for Tony. We can give the gift to Tony. We would want you to hold on for a minute. So all this effort behind, there has been lot of coordination, getting in touch with lot of advisors. So we would like to thank Arun. Arun, why don't you come up on the stage? Please give a huge round of applause for all the effort that's been put here. So we would like to also take this opportunity to thank our facilities team. So this wonderful thing is completely done in-house, so give a huge round of applause to our facility team. And we would also like to thank ISMD team for completely taking care of video, Gokul Bear. So he himself is an ISMD team member. Prasanji Bear, he is an ISMD team member taking photographs. So wonderful job, give a huge round of applause.
You know, Gautam talked about 3D printer, printing 3D printer. Madhu, I can't expect you to give thanks to yourself, so let me do that. Thank you for keeping everybody in line and running the show as usual, very flawless. Thank you.
So before we wind up, so Ramu has something fun for all of you for 3 minutes. So let's just give him a chance for that.
Can you hear me? Yeah. So this is at the end of a really long day. So the reason I'm doing this is a bit of fun. So we are really part of a cool industry. EFI is a really cool organization. And I remember the first time I saw Guy Gesh was at Drupa, where he came for a press conference and said, "Hi, I'm Benny Landa." And I said, "Wow, I mean, how cool is this guy?" So what I've done is, you know, this is a question all of us keep getting asked. What's going to happen to print in 2050? So I've come up with a wish list. I must confess, I wrote this down day before when I had a, you know, root canal extraction. So I was under the influence of anesthesia. So this a little bit of the brain going on overdrive, but while I was lying on the dentist's couch, I said, "What if?" And then, you know, came up with some projections. The reason I'm sharing this with you is I suspect some of it is fun, and the second reason is I suspect some of you might actually take it up, and you know, you might actually make a technology thing out of it. So I'll start off with, in 2050, we'll of course have 3D printers, but EFI will probably print the 3D printer that prints the 3D printer. In 2050, we'll have SIP3. But it will become SIP 10, and the workflow won't stop at integration of pre-press and post-press and press. SIP 10 will integrate dreams into reality, and all reality will become a dream. So effectively, SIP 10 will ensure that you can sort of migrate from, you know, Whitefield to MG Road just using SIP 10. You don't have to go through traffic. In 2050, JDF will still be around. It will still be called JDF, and no one will know what it looks and what it does. In 2050, Apple will still invent, you know, the gadgets. The one that they'll invent in 2050 will have absolutely no sort of value of any kind, but we'll all buy one because it's an Apple product. In 2050, digital will be faster than offset, but offset will be faster than gravure, and gravure will be cheaper than screen, and screen will be less complex than flexo, and letterpress will of course make a comeback. And all these six processes will be part of one press, which will be so small. In 2050, print on demand will become print on crazy demand, and a press will be manufactured in Faridabad that will produce jobs day before yesterday. In 2050, Newton's theory of gravity will gain further importance. Newton will come back on the planet, and this will be particularly true about print prices in India, which will continue to fall below the rupees 80 for 1,000 impressions. In 2050, Benny Landa will still be around. In fact, he would have launched a new press at Printpack, which nobody would have seen, and this press would be capable of printing profits. That's it. In 2050, the English Alphabet Committee will drop six alphabets. These alphabets are CMYK and RB. These alphabets will not be used. Only G will be used because green will be fashionable. Pantone will print gray shades. That is because gray will become the national color. In 2050, printers will still not be able to get their gray balance right. In 2050, color gurus from EFI, including Pancham, will continue to hold color conferences so that printers can attain their gray balances. In 2050, conductive inks will replace blood in human beings, so blood-related lifestyle disease will drop. Health gurus will now start giving gyan on pH and levels and ink water and alcohol balance. Because consumption of alcohol will become compulsory because there's ink in the system, Gujarat will lift its ban on alcohols. Printed books will make a comeback in 2050. The Indian population of 2 billion by then will buy one book a week. This is because books will be available at kirana stores, paan bidi shops, sabzi mandis, coffee kadais, roadside dhabas, and suddenly India's average IQ will go about 200 plus. Top firms like Manipal and Seshashayi will start producing really smart cards. Not smart cards, but really smart cards. So the rationale behind it is smart cards are used about 1%. So the other 99%, what do these cards do? We'll figure out in 2050. When kept idle in the wallet, these really smart cards will hook up to cloud version 2 and hedge fund on the currency on behalf of India. So in one single stroke, the rupees 6 lakh crore fiscal deficit will be wiped out. In 2050, because of the really smart super smart card, India will become the richest country in the world. The rupee will be stronger than the yuan. As a result, there will be now a below Rakesh Jhunjhunwala line and a above Rakesh Jhunjhunwala line. This will replace the below poverty line as the economic benchmark. In 2050, just last two ones, smart packaging will be truly smart. Brown corrugated boxes will serve as smart mobile phones. White folding carton boxes will transform into tiny cars that drive children to school. In 2050, pharma and textiles will merge. So outserts will have multi-purpose use. After you have the medicine, you can wear it as a sari. And inserts will become bed sheets. In 2050, GST will be withdrawn because the government will figure out that it's easier to evade a single tax. So multi-tax regime will come back. In 2050, almost all the printing firms in India will be managed by women. So as a result, all the associations and federations, the newspaper guys, the label guys, the packaging guys, all of them will finally come together and sit across the table and discuss something that the men haven't been able to do for 500 years. And there will be a united common print and packaging front, and India will become the biggest destination. So in 2050, because of the initiative of all these women, the Indian print industry will be the biggest in the world. Uganda and Kenya will be number two. Yeah, I think that's it.
That's wonderful. That's really wonderful. So Gautam, your 2050 statement was missed in this because he couldn't capture it. Okay, so we'll have a group photo with all the advisors. If you could just...